Staff and I have prepared for you an animal ordinance that is before you tonight. It has garnered a lot of, obviously, feedback from the community. Some of that feedback from the community has been interesting because a lot of the community complaints have been addressing things that are currently in your ordinance. For example, defanging of dogs. That's in your current ordinance. It has been removed at your direction from this draft ordinance. There are new provisions associated with things like baiting, which means to attack with violence to provoke or harass any animal. Those have been added at staff direction into the ordinance. You may have heard in the community there's a new provision that has concern about raising bees. That would be misstated. What's in the ordinance with respect to bees is anybody who raises bees in your community, consistently with recommendation from the University of Arizona, must report that they're raising bees. Most bees in this area have now become Africanized, and the city manager then issues a permit for a two-year period to hold bees, as an example. The city manager also, with respect to existing livestock, she has altered the provisions allowing existing livestock to live in the city of Bisbee until that livestock is deceased. But new livestock, which would include mules, horses, cows, for example, those would have to have specific permission and be licensed by the city appropriately. Another issue that has been, I think, has garnered some significant questioning was the issue with respect to feral cat communities. Consistently, again, with the American Humane Society, the American Bird Conservancy, Humane Society of the United States, staff and I have recommended to you that you go away from the feral cat community, which requires capturing, spaying, notching the animal's ears, all of that under your existing ordinances, and instead go to the provision that prohibits the feeding of feral cats.
The city needs to have a more flexible approach when they are looking at things that are restricting what is the nature of our community. The more regulations that we can apply, the less Bisbee is the unique and pleasant place that it was to live in. And we need to really consider whether or not it's the city's job to police the number of chickens that someone has, or down to the minutia that exists in this ordinance. The city has paid lip service to desiring a sustainable community. But if I'm raising chickens, which I do, and I have six chickens, but six chickens are not going to give me enough eggs to supply to someone to the farmer's market, for instance. It makes better sense in your ordinance to look at language that is, rather than saying, I can have six chickens, it is, I can have chickens if I care for them in a manner that is equitable with the standards of good animal husbandry.
You can tell that this is a pretty serious concern for a lot of the citizens of Bisbee here, just by just showing up here. And I know hundreds of other people that would like to be here right now to be able to express their dissatisfaction with this ordinance that you're trying to push through right here. It doesn't make any sense to me whatsoever. I moved to town from a ranch that I was on the outskirts of town, and before I moved in, I came to the city hall and I asked them if I could bring some animals in, and they came out with the city inspector to look at my plot map, and I said, hey, according to how much land you have, you could have up to 3 horses. And I was like, oh, that's amazing. And they said, well, you could have up to 3 of anything that you want. And so I do have some animals in Old Bisbee, and they're precious. They're my pets. They're my love. And I'm really surprised that you guys are trying to wrench out some people that have been raising their pets here in town. So I'm totally against this ordinance, and I'm really surprised that it's being pushed forward. The first line that you have on this ordinance is that the purpose of this ordinance is protect the public health, the safety, and the comfort and convenience and the general welfare in order to secure the social, physical, and economic advantages of the city and the citizens of Bisbee. That means this entire ordinance goes against that one first line that you have written on here. And the way that I see it is that there's going to be a lot of lawsuits, and this is going to be a lot of time that you're all going to have to spend dealing with this as we move on. And so I appreciate all the animals here, animal lovers here in the past, because they are our loved ones unconditionally. They give us the support. They give us comfort. They give us security. Our pets do. And so it's really sad that you can come in at this point and say, hey, sorry, you're grandfathered out.
Numbers don't necessarily mean that your argument having to do with anything is correct.
I am here to just speak specifically on TNR and the feral cat issues. Since I purchased my house 5 years ago, I've been doing trap and release on the row. I noticed there were a lot of ill cats when I bought my house. I have successfully trapped and altered and released, to my knowledge, all of them on my street. 2 years ago, we had upwards of 43 ill, malnourished, malign kittens literally dying in the street in front of my house. And last year, we had one kitten that was taken to the shelter, altered, and adopted out. And I haven't seen any kittens since.
There's so much I dislike about this ordinance, it's hard to know where to start. One of the things that was mentioned was that the grandfathering was going to run with the animal, not with the land use. This is not appropriate. Grandfathering, by its very nature, runs with the land. What are we going to have? Hire some more people to keep check of each animal, see when one dies.
Like to address the poultry and livestock aspect of this, because I'm a senior citizen and a low-income person, and quite frankly, a lot of the food that I derive is from my friends who have livestock, who have chicken eggs, who have rabbits, and things like this. At a time when, as Americans, we feel sometimes less and more, more and more powerless about what's happening to us, about our food chains, about the just the overall concerns about what's being put into our food, it's really wonderful to be able to know where your food's coming from.
I'm here tonight to speak against the proposed animal ordinance. Writing an ordinance of this kind, without fully researching the recommendations of national organizations such as the Humane Society of Arizona, or asking for input from the Bisbee Animal Shelter staff and volunteers, those members of your community that work every day on the ground dealing with these exact issues, is at best an act of complete reckless and oblivious arrogance. someone chose to include at the end of your agenda packet tonight an outdated article from 2004 that speaks against the feeding of feral cats. What was not shared with the public and was not included in your packet is what I find more troublesome. On December 11th, the senior analyst for cat protection and policy for the Humane Society of America and the senior state director for the Humane Society of Arizona wrote a letter to the mayor that says, and I quote, "Banning the feeding of community cats does not make them go away." It goes on to talk about a feeding ban that is ineffective and inhumane policy while detailing better ideas.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The other thing is, why fix things that aren't broken? I mean, I'm especially caught up in the feral cat issue, but has there been a problem with bees and mules? I mean, this is a great way to reduce our census because people live here for certain reasons, and that's one of them, like Radianne said. Let's appoint an ad hoc committee that understands our community and animal issues and is up to date on current animal welfare standards. This obviously wasn't the case.
Banning the feeding of community cats does not make them go away. There are more effective strategies to managing free-roaming cat populations than employing such inhumane measures. Restricting feeding is difficult and costly to enforce and does not address the root cause of the problem and is simply a waste of taxpayer dollars. A feeding ban simply results in unvaccinated, unhealthy cats continuing to live in the community. Spayed and neutered cats are less likely to fight over mates, food, and territory. They roam less and they no longer emit the pungent odor of intact male cat urine. Finally, this community cat program, when implemented effectively, can reduce predation on wildlife. Limiting the feeding of these cats may put native wildlife in danger. Regular feeding of cats at established locations allows caretakers to identify new cats who may be lost or in need of sterilization or rehoming. This is the most effective method to reduce cat populations and the issues related to them. Thank you.
I think the people who are advocates of this ban need to explain how and why they expect this to be an effective solution. Like, step one, there's a ban. Step two, everyone complies. Step three, what, we have like starving zombie cats roaming around? And most important, I'd like for someone to cite a single place where a feeding ban has resulted in successfully reducing the number of feral cats. Because from all the research that I've done, I can't find such a place. So when you're ready to discuss actual effective solutions for community cats that the whole community can participate in and get behind, Friends of the Animal Shelter is ready to sit down with you. And so is the Humane Society of the United States, to whose attention this issue has been brought.
A petty offense, which you'll see a lot on there. It's no jail time, it's a type of misdemeanor, and you get up to a $300 fine. So if you feed something you're not supposed to, okay, you can get up to a $300 fine. You get a class 2 misdemeanor, you have a maximum of 4 months in jail, $700 fine up to and a surcharge, and 2 years probation. And that'll stay on your record for 99 years. You can try to pay an expunge, near to nothing of a chance. So you can have that on your record forever.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you very much.
People have come up and talked about several different areas of this ordinance in total, indicating that they're against the ordinance. I'm somewhat confused with, I believe that they're against certain parts of the ordinance. Some may be against the whole ordinance because some are against any ordinance. We are listening to the community. Obviously, you all are definitely a part of the community, but you are not the community. You're a portion of the community. I also just wanted to indicate that several of the people that have come up here talking about the feral cats and feeding feral cats are some of the very people that I've received phone calls from complaining about neighbors feeding feral cats. I doubt that anybody here is, has nobody's jumped up and said, I'm for feeding I think we should not feed feral cats. Sometimes that's called the silent majority, but I don't know that. But what I am indicating is we act on what we're told. And that this is an item that has been before us, that I've discussed personally with a number of you in this audience for some, at least 5 years, and have not been provided good concrete answers as to how we accomplish, particularly the feral cat issue. Dana is the only, Kelly, please keep it down. Dana is the only one that I know of that has actually had the issue that apparently is solved. And I think it's interesting because as soon as this proposal came out, which has been advertised and has been available to anybody, and most people have read it, that as soon as it came out, all of a sudden the calls that I was getting personally about feral cats, particularly in Old Bisbee, ceased, as if they all went away. And I hope they did. But it's just a very strange circumstance that once something is drafted to take a drastic step on it, all of a sudden it seems like the problem isn't as great a problem as it was.
You know, the complaints about the feral cats wasn't about feral cats that were altered and trapped, neutered, and released and being fed. It was the fact that there are certain cats that were not trapped, neutered, and released and taken care of that were causing the problem. And people's hands were tied, and that was causing the issue.
I'm unhappy with the fact that there's one sentence in here that says it's against the law to feed feral cats. I don't think that's an effective solution to this problem. My primary objective here is to address TNR versus you can't feed the cats. I've seen a lot of literature from people in the community. I've talked to people in the community, and I've done some research on my own. I can't find anything that supports a ban on feeding feral cats.
Dana made a very good point when she stated the population on Goat Row, I might say, has been taken under control. I have friends that live down there. I've been on that road for many years, and I've noticed a substantial decrease in the cat population. I said that kind of facetiously, but Goat Row got its name because of the livestock that used to be allowed in this town. And unfortunately, sometimes when we go in quickly and try to enforce things, it causes problems because practices have already been put into place. And coming in now and tightening the noose, so to speak, quickly, is causing problems for people that have relied on food sources and these animals.
Does the black cat need to come sit down here?
No.
If you need to sit down here, you may. Otherwise, you can
okay.
Stay where you are. I just was giving you that opportunity.
Working in the city of Bisbee and volunteering in the city of Bisbee, I come into contact with a lot of tourists. And many of them find the quirkiness and the uniqueness of the goat lady, and when cat dog rat guy was here, and the pygmy goats. These are things that kind of give Bisbee its personality, and I don't want to see that taken away.
The bees have been there forever. When I first moved to Arizona, people said, I had some allergies, and people said, eat the local honey, and that will help you with your allergy problem. You can't get honey much more local than the honey that I was eating. It was right around the street from me, right down the street, actually. And I would hate to see that go away. So, you know, not to feed the feral cats, I'd hate to see a situation here in Bisbee where people were afraid to walk down Grofey Avenue for fear of being attacked by feral cats. And as far as the livestock goes, you know, people have had, you know, I was actually amazed when I first came here that, you know, actually, more or less, in some backyards here, there's horses, you know, and within the city limits. And really what it's about is being a good neighbor. And a lot of people aren't good neighbors. There are people that they keep barnyards right next to their next door neighbor, and they stink, they're full of feces, they attract flies, they make noise, They're irritating as hell. And we have to have some means of controlling that kind of behavior. It's a city. We live in a little tiny city in Old Bisbee, for sure.
No.
Let's keep it.
This is my turn to talk. You've had your turn.
Okay.
I agree with Bill on this as far as, those that can keep a reasonable amount of chickens or whatnot on their property for their own use or for, their family's, eggs or whatnot. I think that's good. But we know that there are some that violate this a lot.
I hope that the citizens feel that you've been heard and that you're being answered the best that I think you could be answered at this particular point. And that's a do-over. I will be on the next meeting asking the council to allow me to appoint an ad hoc committee so that this ordinance will be looked at by that committee. I'm going to specifically in public ask that either Ms. Galligan or Ms. Souden be a member of that committee for direct input. And Ms. Giacomino, hopefully you could participate.
Can I ask a question? Can we open it up to possible members of the ward also to volunteer with the agency?
If members of the public would please just, all you need to do is go online or stop at the office, ask for a volunteer, for committee application and fill that out. And then that'll come to me. That gives us enough time where if the council allows me to appoint a committee this next meeting, then the committee will be appointed the first meeting in February. And that gives them the month of February and March to come back with recommendations that will go back through council to make sure that there's legal, that the recommendations are legal.